Hello, ola kita, tāna whalawa, mālo elele. Welcome to Tangata Pasifika.
Whakalofalahi atu, taloha nei on the show today.
The Māngere manager keeping an eye on her community.
The approach that we've tried to do here at the town centre is like just literally sit down and talk to them.
How looking good can make you feel good.
Once we realise our self-worth, man, we can do whatever we want.
And the Cook Islands firefighters taking on the Sky Tower Challenge.
Our pain today is no way closer to the pain our families went through. We can't see.
Beautiful.
But first, we're going to do things a little bit differently on the show from now on.
That's right. Given the speed at which things change these days, our news stories will now be found online on our Facebook page or on our website, tpplus.co.nz.
And it means we can do more of those stories more often and give you more in-depth content on the show. And as you can see, where's John Pulu? I'm here with Alistair because John's away on the Pacific mission.
Yes.
So talking about that, let's have a look at this week. What can you tell us about the Pacific mission?
Yeah, well, the mission happens, is something that happens every year. So the Foreign Affairs Minister, Winston Peters, leads a delegation of New Zealand MPs and ministers.
Community leaders.
That's right. And this week they went to the Solomon Islands in Vanuatu. And I think what's amazing about this trip is it gives, highlights the local heroes in the Solomon Islands in Vanuatu, people that are working on the ground, really making a change, a difference there.
Okay. Another thing happening this week, of course, in the headlines is across the Tasman, Israel Folau. We've all been watching what's been happening with him in terms of him being sacked.
That's right.
Now he's saying he's going to sue Rugby Australia and the Waratahs for $10 million.
That's a massive amount, and I can only imagine sort of the effect that it might have on other Pacific Island players or, you know, in the industry at the time over there.
That's right. I mean, a few of them already spoke out on social media a couple of weeks ago. Now his brother John Folau is saying has been released from his contract. Obviously, standing in solidarity with his brother. But it'll be interesting to see if others would go that far. I'm not sure if
that's right. It's a big deal, so it's something that we'll have to watch. But another athlete I have to tell you that I've been keeping my eye on is our weightlifter, Kaina Andrews-Nahu. She's amazing. She's won the first ever New Zealand gold medal at the Junior World Champs this week in Fiji. So exciting to watch. She's breaking records all over the show, so it'll be awesome to see what she does leading up to the Pacific Games.
Awesome. And actually, a more serious issue, something else happening in the news, homelessness. Still, it's a very big issue, housing for our community. You've got something coming up on the show about that.
That's right. Later on, we'll be talking to Ronji Tanielu from the Salvation Army. He'll be telling us about the current housing climate and where our Pacific people stand in amongst that, really. So that's coming up later on in the show.
Very cool. And while we're still on that issue, the Māngere Town Centre has been the beating heart of the community for over 30 years. Now, while it's a centre for commerce and business, of course, it's also been a shelter for the less fortunate. To lend a helping hand are centre staff like Tony Halur. Soana Aholele has the story.
It's a cold late night here at the Māngere Town Centre and locals are happy going about their business. It's been the throbbing heart of this diverse community for many years. Keeping an eye on things is Samoan Niuean Tony Halua, who's being employed by the centre as a crimes prevention officer.
So when you started a couple of years ago, was the town centre like this or was it a bit, you know, what's the difference?
I have to admit it was our youth was my first priority. They were running rampant.
So what's changed now? Where are they?
We've done a lot of work with the youth and we had better connections with our police, our MPT team. The police have introduced youth engagement officers, and I have to admit that's been the most amazing part of it. We said if you respect the town centre, we can look after you better. And that's been our whole approach.
Is it a safer place here?
I hope so. I did a survey end of last year about that, just to see what the perception from the shopkeepers and from the public, and it's been really positive.
The town centre's had its fair share of ups and downs, but these days the main concern is how to cope with the increasing presence of homeless people and beggars.
I think a lot of people's perception is that they are homeless. We've got more beggars than homeless.
So what are we doing about that? How are we helping them?
Yeah, so the approach that we've kind of tried to do here at the town centre is like just literally sit down and talk to them. That's how we approach it, that's how I approach it. And just really to get their full story. You know, what's happened and why are you around here and how can we help?
Tony says they do their best to help people and connect them with social support services, but not everyone can be helped.
So where are they normally? Are they normally here in the shrubs?
Yeah, pretty much all amongst the flats. And it is a place of a lot of our, you know, even our rough sleepers, our children, this is usually where we'll find them.
So this is their tent where they would sleep at night?
Yep.
Do you think they still come here?
No, not at the moment because it's down, but I got told, and we've yet to go find them again, they've moved to David Longy Park only because they know the Auckland Council is coming in to thin out the flats. Quite sad, but this is the place. This is better than where they were sleeping before, which was up on the dairy, just over here, on the main road. Like, I'll come to work in the morning and they'll be asleep.
Among those who have come to Tony's attention is a young mum known as Billy Jo, who together with her partner is living on the streets.
I first came across them when I first started in the role, and they pretty much rough slept outside Māngere East, outside KFC and Limbs Takeaway. They've been on the streets for 4 years. She's had a couple of kiddies while being on the streets. And again, it's not really by choice why they're here. I've always known that. Drug, alcohol, that tends to fuel it and keeps them the way they are. And that is a really, really hard habit to really kick.
Also helping people survive is Kai from Sai, a food service run by volunteers of the Satna Sai faith, who provide free meals at the centre on a Thursday night. Tony arranged for them to be here, and they're happy to help out.
We are just motivated through love, and we thought that because it's winter and we started last year, and the idea came up because of the homeless and the needy, and we thought that what can we do in some little way to help them to appease their situation. You could see the smile and even the appreciation, thank you. You didn't expect that, but suddenly they'll come up and say thank you, and even a compliment that the meal was nice, and we'll see you again next week.
Kai from Sai provide this service in neighbouring Otahuhu as well, and while it's a welcome effort, there's still a long way to go to fix homelessness. In the meantime, people like Tony at the Māngere Town Centre continue to do their bit for their community.
Great work, Tony, and there are so many amazing people doing incredible things in our community. We just want to also congratulate all the Pasifika people who were named in the Queen's Birthday Honours List over the long weekend.
Absolutely. The People's Champion, David Tua, was made an Officer of the New Zealand Order of Merit, and Felicia Brown Acton was also honoured for her work, so congratulations to them.
Well done, Felicia, and great to see some of our smaller communities' heroes honoured. Whala Haulangi, the Queen of Tuvalu. And also many Tokelauans in there as well, Vaha Tuielu, Reverend Tui Sopoanga, and Mrs. Leo Tuvalvasa, as well as many other people in our community.
Congratulations to all of them. Well, stay with us after the break. We look at housing for the homeless in our talanoa, and later, a fashion show giving women the confidence to conquer.
There's definitely a need to support other women to access the types of clothes that they would need for you know, a job interview, but they may not always have the disposable income.
Kia ora and welcome back to Tagata Pasifika. Well, this week, a lot of the headlines have been about the homeless, the increase in rent, the conditions of state housing, and that's brought to light the struggle of our most vulnerable. No major funding has gone into housing from the budget, leaving advocates feeling disappointed. Well, joining us to talk through the issues is Salvation Army lawyer and analyst Ronji Tanielu. Talofa Ronji, thank you for joining us.
Talohani, thanks for having me.
So let's get into the budget. In terms of housing, it left much to be desired. What are your concerns there?
I think overall there was some really good investment in other areas, but I think in terms of housing, I think it was pretty disappointing. There's about $200 million that's going into housing first, so that's going to focus on homelessness. So that's a plus. There's about $280 million going into transitional housing, so that's those in emergency housing and transitional housing. So look, there's something in the budget, but in other areas it's pretty disappointing.
Yeah, I understand what you're saying because, you know, this was the wellbeing budget, so obviously there were there was a huge focus on health and mental health. But look, another thing that's sort of been announced is the 2.5 million boost, you know, in terms of Pacific home ownership. Mm. There's all these initiatives being announced. What do you think the government needs to focus on right now in the immediate?
I think overall it's really difficult for Pacific people to get into home ownership. The statistics say that from 2013, only 18% of Pacific adults owned a home, 18%. So that's a challenging number to deal with. So in order to get into home ownership, you need to decrease the cost of housing. Hey, so most Pacific families can't afford Kiwi board prices. Mm. You need to increase financial literacy and capability. There needs to be more investment from government around shared equity schemes. That's something we've been asking for a long time. So there's a couple of ways that you can help transition Pacific people into home ownership.
And just explain to me a little bit about what the shared equity sort of program, what your ideas from the Salvation Army have been.
Yeah, we've been advocating for a campaign called Kiwi Buy, which helps people get into home ownership. And so Pacific people are key to our campaign, and part of that essentially is like a rent to buy or a shared equity. So the family would bring part of the deposit, government would bring part of the deposit or the community housing provider, and then there's a chance to go into a house together. So that's one of the key ways we think will help Pacific people and other people get into houses.
Right, because you know, at both ends of this housing continuum there needs to be help all round and across the scale. You know, you need to get people off the streets, but also on this end getting more Pacific people into their own homes. Where do you think the focus of the funding should go from the government?
I would personally advocate that there needs to be more work around home ownership for Pacific people. So that's one thing, and there is a couple of million that's there. I don't think that's enough. I think there's a lot of money that's going into the sharper end of where Pacific people are. I mean, 15% of the social housing register are Pacific people. So those who are essentially homeless or looking for a place to live. So that's double our Pacific population. So there needs to be work across the spectrum. At this stage, there's a lot of work at the sharper end, not enough for families that want to get into home ownership. 65% of Pacific people are in rental, and that's not good enough for Pacific people. So we need to transition them into home ownership. So work across.
Yeah, that's right. Well, in the meantime, we are seeing how people in New Zealand are coping. You know, in the headlines, there's been a lot of talk about the West Auckland Caravan Park. Sure. How, from your experience, how have you seen our Pacific people coping?
Look, like the previous story, homelessness and rough sleeping is really difficult to measure. And so we are still seeing at the Salvation Army families in cars, those that are turning up who are homeless or rough sleeping. But you have to define whether they're rough sleeping and homeless or they're just homeless. So it's a difficult thing to measure. But 40% of the housing waiting list is in Auckland. So we know that it's a massive Auckland issue, and there are a lot of Pacific people on that waiting list. And so people are coping by any means. I mean, it's leading to overcrowding, it's leading to other issues. And so can I just say, if you know people that are homeless, if you know people that are struggling, rough sleeping, there are options and alternatives out there. Let WINS know, come and see a charity, come and let an advocate know, because it's getting into winter. We don't want people to be suffering in the cold. So there are options.
Yeah, I mean, well, what do you think? Do you think we're closer to solving this homelessness, this housing crisis issue?
You can't just throw money at an issue and think that it's going to work. You need grassroots solutions going to happen on the ground that create change, that disrupt some of the issues that are helping there. I mean, the previous story talked about addictions issues and the other holistic social issues that people are going through. So you need grassroots change, but you need macro policy, big picture change. And I don't think the government has made enough wise investments in that space, and so I think it didn't really lead to a wellbeing budget when you've ignored housing as a key part of wellbeing.
Well, whawhitau te le lava, cool. Ronji, for joining us this morning. Thank you for your comments.
Thanks,
and also, you know, as Ronji said, if you need help, please, there is help, so do reach out. So when we come back, fashion's role in boosting confidence, and firefighters take the Sky Tower Steer Challenge.
We've buried loved ones through cancer. I've got a 15 and a 13-year-old daughter, and it's not to think far. You know, I hope my children won't go down this road.
Firefighters
Whakatālo pa aunty. Welcome back to Tangata Pasifika. Well, Pasifika stylist Nora Swan says confidence isn't just about what you wear, but about knowing your self-worth.
Yes, and for the past 4 years, she's been running a program in schools teaching young women to harness their potential using fashion as the driver. Taylor Almoa caught up with Nora to see what it's all about.
What about this one?
Digging deep into the racks of Save Mart to find a runway-ready outfit, proving that clothes that make you feel confident don't need to come with a hefty price tag, but requires a little digging into ourselves.
We've discussed things as, you know, what our favourite physical features are, and, you know, we go back to, you know, things you've inherited from your loved ones, like we traditionally have bushy hair. Some of us have dominant Pasifika noses. We've got certain body types, and we should be celebrating and embracing those.
Nora usually runs dressed in confidence with girls in primary and intermediate schools, but this time the Ministry of Social Development has provided funding to help these women keen to get back into employment.
The program is a wellness program which teaches girls about self-love and self-worth with fashion as the driver.
Try it on, that's cool. Mm-hmm.
This morning we went to Save Mart for the thrift shop challenge. So every single girl was given $10 and they needed to put together an outfit because that outfit's going to be worn on the runway in a couple of weeks' time as our finale slash prize giving.
What shoes do you have in mind?
Why not show everything that they've learnt over the past couple of weeks and put that on the stage for their family and loved ones to see?
I hadn't been working for a long time, and a difficult relationship and other things as well. So this has really helped me sort of come out of my shell and enjoy being around other people. She got us to all sort of look in front of the mirror and say our tagline, sort of like, oh, I can do this, I've got this. And we all sort of struggled, and then after we did it a couple of times, we were all like pretty good at it.
That's a bit hard. Just to like look at yourself and try and telling yourself positive things. For me, I didn't like my teeth. I never really liked my teeth because, you know, the whole bullying thing back in the day, I never really liked to smile with my teeth. Got over it, I was kind of like, these are my teeth. Deal with it, they help me eat.
I feel more confident. Like, I will buy that bold pink top now.
Once we realise our self-worth, man, we can do whatever we want.
It's a cause 13 of our Pasifika women in leadership have also rallied behind, walking the catwalk to raise funds for a Dressed in Confidence Wellness Centre to be established in South Auckland in 2020.
There is absolutely a need for a centre like this in terms of empowering and building the confidence of women, of girls. This is, you know, there is a big gap.
Funds will go towards the $100,000 goal needed to establish the centre that will empower women with wellness programs, employment readiness and work attire.
There's definitely a need to support other women to access the types of clothes that they would need for you know, a job interview, but they may not always have the disposable income.
I think women in every community need to be reminded of their worth. Our Pacific youth have high aspirations but lower expectations. What that suggests to me is belief, and having someone have the belief in our young people, but more so having our young people believe in themselves.
Very cool.
Great work, ladies. And speaking of confidence, the Miss Samoa New Zealand pageant was held last night, popular as ever. Congratulations to the winner, Whonui Whafo Nancy McFarlane Seal Manu, who won.
Woohoo! Congratulations. OK, well, the Race Up Auckland Sky Tower is in its 15th year now, with firefighters from around the world raising funds for leukemia and blood cancer research.
And for the first time, a group of 8 Cook Islands firefighters, Cook Islands world domination here, travelled from the islands to take part. And Star, I know you went along with them to check it out.
It's normally crawling with tourists here, but this time the fire brigades are taking over. They've come from around the world to scale the tallest building in the country, all 51 floors. That's over 1,000 steps, and they're doing it while kitted out in 25 kgs worth of gear.
We're in our full structure firefighting gear, so what we would wear to a fire. We've got our trousers, our jacket, our level 2 structure boots, our helmet, our gloves, and then we've got our BA backplate and cylinder.
Among them are 8 Cook Islands firefighters who travelled from Rarotonga to put their physical and mental strength to the test.
We've been getting up early for the last 6 months, twice a week, training at the Hospital Hill at our local stadium.
For the last 9 months, we've been wearing this maybe twice a week, so your body's used to it. But with the 1,103 steps, it's got to be a different story today.
I really wanted to do it because I wanted to be the first Cook Island team to do it, and we found out that no other Cook Island team had done it, and so it was a good promotion for the Volunteer Fire Brigade.
But more importantly, they're here to raise funds for those affected by leukemia and blood cancers, a personal endeavour for them all.
We've buried loved ones through cancer. I've got a 15 and a 13-year-old daughter, and you start to think far, you know. I hope my children won't go down this road.
I personally have had family and friends affected by leukemia and cancer, so for me that's my personal motivation, but it's just an awesome event for firefighters worldwide to come together as brothers and sisters and support each other.
Our pain today is nowhere closer to the pain our families went through, cancer.
Despite the struggle to the top, they powered their way up through the tower. And at the end, exhaustion and fatigue clearly showing. But for the Cook Islands contingent, it was more than worth it.
Oh, well, I survived. It was hard. I was not worried about me, I just think of our families that have gone. It's not for one person, it's for everybody.
These guys have trained so hard and fundraised really hard too for the cause, Leukemia and Blood Cancer New Zealand, so super proud of them. So yeah, looking forward to next year already.
Great work, guys. You'll be there next year as well, eh?
Absolutely. No, that's not a promise.
Well, that's almost the end of our show for this week. If you want to watch any of our stories again, you can go to our fabulous website, tpplus.co.nz. Also, our Facebook page or TVNZ On Demand.
That's right. And before we go, some great things happening around Aotearoa today.
That's right.
The Pacific Dance Festival opened this week, and that's on in Okilani till the 23rd of June.
Have a great week, everyone. Tō whakoto.
Ka kite.
Love the sun to our new homebound.